You're watching What She Said on YouTube.
And joining us now is a woman who barely needs an introduction. You've seen her. You've heard her voice for 20 years. You can hear the jingle in your sleep. In fact, Kate and I were kind of humming it this morning. Welcome to our Simply the Best guest, Christine Magee, the president and co-founder of Sleep Country Canada.
Thank you, Christine and Kate. It's wonderful to be here. Thanks for inviting me.
Oh. Now, just so our listeners understand just how successful you and your company are, you started with four stores in British Columbia in 1994. How many stores, how many employees do you now have?
So in Sleep Country, we have 165 stores. We also have Dormez-vous, which is in Quebec, and we have 47 stores there, and we have operations in Tucson and Arizona as well.
That's Sleep America.
Right? Yes, it is, Tucson and Phoenix. So just over 1,200 members of our team.
Wow.
So, yeah, and this is our 20th anniversary, so we're very excited.
That's an amazing growth.
Yes, thank you. Yeah, no, you know what, and it's been a lot of work, a lot of concentration, but certainly because of our great team that we have.
Well, it's quite a culture that you have, from the top down.
Well, you know, it is about, it is something we've worked on very, very hard for the last 20 years. And every member of our team that joins us has the ability to affect that. And so, you know, culture isn't static. It's something that you continue to work on. It's like every relationship that you have. Mm-hmm. And so for us, it is about making sure that our team feel empowered, they feel rewarded and recognized. And at the end of the day, the real business happens with the customer. It is that face-to-face. You know, it's in-store, home delivery, aftercare service. So that culture is so critical for our team to feel that they can make a difference. And so my job and our leadership team is to support them.
So. Well, Christine's son is pretty picky when it comes to service, and he's just moving into a new condo. And she was telling me in the car on the way down that he was complimenting the service, so I mean, which is unusual for him. Trust me.
He's in the real estate development business, and he's really picky about service.
Right.
And he said, "Wow," because he said, "I want to buy a mattress." I said, "Go to Sleep Country. You don't even have to buy there. Just try." He said, "How could I not buy there? They're amazing. They gave me all the advice. Any." You know, I mean, they matched anything. They were willing to they were willing to do anything.
Well, Christine, Kate, that's what we tried to do. Like 20 years ago, this was a highly competitive industry. It still is. But to differentiate ourselves from the competition, we really wanted to provide that in-store and home delivery. It is about making sure that we really address the customer's needs. It's a consultative approach. Mm-hmm. And, you know, at the end of the day, we can talk about sleep, but sleep is so important. And one of the factors that can affect your sleep is the quality of your sleep system and your pillow. And so it does take real-time effort training, and then for a customer like your son to come in and actually enjoy the process, right? It's one of those things. It's an infrequent purchase. It's a big-ticket item. It's hard to compare. And so we want to make sure that when a customer comes in, we help them match the right mattress, pillow, that sleep system to their needs.
Okay, I'm so interested that you've started to do pillows, because you didn't. Pillows is relatively
right.
new,
mm-hmm.
right? Because mm-hmm. a friend of mine, they just came back from Europe, and they found out that you were going to be on, and they said she should go into business in Europe because the pillows there truly suck. They're little, they're little things that you couldn't possibly lean up against. Now, I have gone through a variety of pillows.
Mm-hmm.
I have the menopause pillow that has cooling stuff on it.
Yep.
I have, I've tried ones that are like grains. I've tried just the bolster.
Mm-hmm.
I still end up, sleeping with my arm like under there. So
right.
Why did you decide to involve pillows?
Well, again, it's like one of those things as you start 20 years ago and you evolve your business and you understand what's really important in terms of sleep and comfort support.
Mm-hmm.
We really began to understand that your pillow is where, you know, is as much a part of your sleep system because it supports your neck and your shoulder area. And it's funny because initially I don't think people understood that, right? They didn't really understand how important your pillow was to that process. And so one of the things we started to do was really think about, okay, if you're a side sleeper, a back sleeper, a front sleeper, the loft of your pillow really matters, right? And then we also wanted to make sure that the customer who comes in, if you normally buy a pillow, In any other kind of a retail environment, it's usually still wrapped in plastic. You smush it apart onto the side of your face. You don't get a chance to really test it. So part of our process was that we really need to test that process. We need to allow our customer to lie down on a bed and help select the pillow that's going to, based on their sleep system, like their sleeping habit. What gives them the right support? What maintains their curvature in their back? You know, and at the end of the day, when we wake up in the morning and our neck is sore or it's lumpy or those sorts of things, you know, it really does affect your sleep. And we came to understand that.
Mm-hmm. So when did you, I mean, you started out with that idea about service from day one. Mm-hmm. How did you know, starting out, that that was the biggie? Because it is, for me, it's a bigger deal than price, is the service.
Well, certainly. And you know what? Truthfully, both are. I mean, that value proposition is so important. All of us, you know, need to make sure that we know that we're getting great value. And so we know we could do that. But we also understood the reality that it is an infrequent purchase, and it's so important. So as we looked at the retail landscape, highly competitive, but the current retail models really didn't lend itself to this category. And when we looked at it, we thought, okay, at the end of the day, because it's infrequent and it is something that's so important, it's one of those retail categories where I think a customer really wants great service. And so when we looked at the landscape, we said, you know, no one is really doing that in-store selection, helping, you know, the price guarantee, the comfort guarantee, take away all those objections that you might have when you go and buy a mattress. And then at the end of the day, too, it's a bulky item. How do you get it into your home? What's the convenience of actually setting it up and taking away, you know, the old mattress? And we set up relationships with our with organizations so that it could be reused. And now you either 100%, it either goes to a charity or it goes to recycling. And so our aim was to really make sure that the experience of the customer was to match them to the right product. And when we looked at the 20 years ago, that wasn't apparent. That wasn't what was being offered. And we really set out to change that experience. And that's what we've worked at from the very beginning. When I get asked about what we focus on, top of mind, so you know about Sleep Country, if and when you decide to buy mattress or pillow, we focus on in-store and home delivery. And those are the things that we continue to really, really make sure that we do well day in and day out.
Okay, let's go back 20 years, because there you were, National Bank, right? In the banking business. Mm-hmm. Tell us the story about how you got plucked out of that and started all this.
So, as you said, Kate, I was in the banking industry for 13 years, commercial, corporate, and some mergers and acquisitions. And I met my future business partner, Steve Gunningcourt Lowndes, during the banking industry, while I was in the banking industry, because they had a mergers and acquisition company, Kenra Capital. And it had done the management buyout of Simmons Canada, which is a manufacturer from Simmons US.
Right.
And that really created the kernel of the idea, where we actually had a chance to see inside the manufacturing industry, but as well the retail concept. And so as they continued to be involved, and as I looked at that transaction, it's certainly the opportunity within the category we started to understand. The industry itself, you know, you replace your mattress every 8 to 10 years, you got a growing population, you have this increasing awareness in the importance of sleep and your mattresses of that in that process. And so the industry was attractive, and as we've already spoken about, the actual retail landscape, I think, was the time to come in and do something different and really provide an exceptional experience. And so that's how we got into this industry.
Well, you, though, were an employee. So you got a paycheck, you worked for somebody, and suddenly you jump into this entrepreneurial stream. And you moved clear across the country. And did that feel natural, or was that really
scary?
Tough?
Well, you know what? It was both. Interesting, because I always wanted to start my own business. As I went off to university, I wanted to be a doctor, or I wanted to be in journalism or in business. And through the course of my schooling, I decided that business was the right way. I went into banking.
Good decision, I might add.
Not bad. I think it worked out okay.
Yeah.
But, you know, as part of that process, I wanted to go and create an opportunity to test my knowledge, build my knowledge, my understanding of different industries. And so, and I was doing relatively well at the bank, by the way. I was the most senior woman in commercial lending at National Bank in Ontario at the time. And so for me to have made that decision when Steve and Gord approached me, and they did, to join them as their partner and also to accept the role of spokesperson, certainly I and my husband, by the way, because I was married at the time, we had to weigh the reality, that balance of risk, failure against success. And at the end of the day, I think we did come to the conclusion that it was great. The downside is what you had to accept, that if it had failed, we still would have been extremely better off as it related to understanding how to start the business. Mm-hmm. Our skills would have been developed. I certainly would be better prepared to start my next company. And then if the company was to be successful, certainly the opportunity up therein was going to be tremendous. And so I think anyone who's contemplating, you know, do they go out and start their own business, needs to, or any decision they make, you know, you need to categorize the risks and decide, am I prepared to take that downside? And at the time, we were prepared to take the downside. We you know, at the end of the day, I thought I was ultimately employable. And when I came back, I would still, if the company failed, be able to find a job, start a new company. And my husband and I together both agreed that this was a great opportunity. And I have great business partners. And, you know, we thought we had a business plan that if we executed properly, would indeed be successful. And it was all about execution.
Well, Christine, I know that you had a number of challenges, and we'd like to talk about some of those challenges on the other side of the break.
You're watching What She Said on YouTube.
Before the break, we were talking about the decision you made with your husband moving across the country to BC from Ontario to take a shot on a business.
Right.
And you said part of that decision was, am I going to have a family? Am I not? Mm. How did that factor in?
Yeah, a decision that men don't necessarily have to make.
Well, certainly. I think, you know, I get asked occasionally. I mean, I didn't have children when the opportunity presented itself and when my husband and I had to sell everything we own, quit our jobs and move out west. But I also had to contemplate the reality that I was 34, turning 35, when I started Sleep Country with my business partner. So I still wanted to have a family. And I share that when I speak often to a variety of women or entrepreneurs and particularly college students who are still in the prime of deciding what they want to do. And I said, you know, at the end of the day, I could have perhaps talked myself out. I don't know, had I had children, would I have accepted that decision to join Gord and Steve. But I certainly knew that I was going to have kids. And because of that, I could have perhaps talked myself out of not accepting this opportunity, continuing to work with the bank, which was a very reasonable career and I was doing well in it. But I thought, you know, at the end of the day, I am just going to cross that bridge if I'm so blessed when it comes to it. And that optimism really was important in kind of, you know, throwing caution to the wind and going, I will manage through that process. And to lean in, like Sheryl Sandberg talks about, versus leaning out, where you choose to do something in your career in the anticipation that there may be other constraints. And I think, you know, one of the things that as I look in my career, it's just seizing the opportunity, finding out a way to make it happen, right? And, you know, follow your dream. And there will be, you know, there are certain things that were available in my life to certainly help me, the support of my husband, your support system. As I continued in my business and I then found myself having two daughters, the opportunity to start to delegate to a team who were ready and able, and by the way, were so willing to take on responsibility, that I realized that they were there and I needed to actually start to move some of those skills and some of those responsibilities to a team that wanted it. And they were very able to handle it, maybe better than I in certain roles, because they were focused on that as opposed to me keeping it all as, you know, the president and operating the business. So, you know, there were so many lessons learned during that process about just going and doing it, seizing the opportunity and using your support system's internal home as well as business and colleagues in order to make the transition as as I garnered a family and continued to operate the business.
So it must have been easier when you came back to Ontario, because I take it most of your family, both sides of you, here, because you guys went to high school together, didn't you?
Yes. Kate, you knew that. That's right. I forgot about it. Yes, I've been with 30 years will be in February will be my wedding anniversary.
Wow.
My husband may not remember that, so I hope he's okay. I'll tell him.
Well, now that you are a success, let's go back 20 years to when you made, you traveled across the country.
Mm-hmm.
There must have been huge challenges then, if you can remember. And what were they?
Certainly. Well, you know what? One of the things I say, because people find it interesting, how do you make the transition from going from the corporate world mm-hmm. to running your own business and building that? And so I generally reply to say that I think the same attributes that make you successful in being successful in the corporate world or whatever avenue of life you're following will be very paramount and important when you start your business. And you know, they are the issues of competency, commitment, perseverance, and integrity. And I know everyone hears those, but I think those are the things that played very well in my role. For example, like if you think about competency, you know, we're not born with the skills we need in order to do our job today. We learn them. Leadership, there are many factors around leadership that can be learned. I see it among my team as they take on more responsibility to how to lead, how to articulate, being connected with the individuals that are actually, you know, performing the skills and making sure that those are being done well. So I think, you know, the obligation for us in anything we do is to learn as much as we can by everything we do. There is no one straight path to any destination. And I think that's a very important thing. You know, my business partner and I, we've talked about the fact that I graduated from Western, 13 years in the banking industry, start my company with Steve. Steve Gunn was an engineer, then an MBA from Western, mm-hmm. a McKinsey consultant, had his own little mergers and acquisition business. And now we are business partners, you know, and our offices are beside each other. We share the same passion for the company. But 25 years ago, neither of us would have thought we were doing what we were doing. So I think, you know, you have to just, competency has been a big factor. Commitment, you got to go and just spend the time and do it. So there, those same attributes that make you successful in whatever you do, I think were very, very important for me in starting Sleep Country and building it the way we did.
And okay, but you seem to grasp branding before most people knew what a force it was. What made you... Talk about that
sure.
and what made you decide to become the very famous face of the company.
So again, you know, in our category, I don't know when you will wake up in the morning and decide that you need a mattress or in now a pillow, right? And then there are life stages that impact on when you might be in this market. You know, you get married, you have a child, you know, you move into your first home, you get mm-hmm. a job, all those things. And because it's an infrequent purchase every 8 to 10 years, I, as a retailer, don't know exactly when you're going to be in the market.
Right.
So part of our strategy was certainly to go into a city and blanket the city with advertising in order, and that was very unconventional, by the way, from mm-hmm. our category. And it was to create a top of mind awareness so that when you woke up and you thought you needed a good night's sleep and your mattress wasn't giving you that, that you knew about Sleep Country and you knew my name and you knew what we did. So it was really to create that top of mind awareness. And 20 years ago, we wanted to do that electronically. Radio and TV. It's very intrusive. It's repetitive. You cannot get away from me on the dial. My mom used to say, enough already with the ads, Chris. We get the picture. But as a philosophy, we just wanted to be top of mind so that you knew. And we use those mediums to talk about not only the value proposition, you know, that you're going to get good value at Sleep Country because you will. Great prices, great product. But it's also those services because mm-hmm. we'll help you find the mattress that's right for you. So that was the philosophy of our advertising. We understood that branding on a national basis about the quality of experience that you should have was so critical. Then the decision was which of us, as our three partners, should be the spokesperson. And I'd never been in a recording studio or, you know, in this case, or in camera. But at the time, 20 years ago, it generally was believed, research would say that if a couple came in, it was the wife who would make the final decision.
85% women make 85% of the buying decisions.
Absolutely. So what better way than to have the female president, one of the co-founding partners, also be that spokesperson? And I also think just from a company perspective, you know, we're all consumers. I think it's very credible when someone from the company stands up and talks about the services we offered. Not a faceless corporation, not just, you know, the jingle. And I'm really proud of our team. I mean, I really am. I think it's important for, you know, our customers and the market to understand what we do and how we're trying to make a difference in their lives by sleep and the quality of their experience. And so, you know, I was going to say gladly took that role. I reluctantly took that role because it's, you put yourself out there.
Exactly.
And by the way, had the company, you know, we moved out west, had the company failed, that would be a very public failure. And so, you know, it's why it was so important that we did it right. And I take my role very, very seriously, even this morning. You know, articulating what we do is so important because I represent 1,200 members of my team that do it every single day.
Now, one thing that's different about you is that there are so many...
Well, there could
many,
be a few.
Well,
there
are lots of things that are different, but unique about you is that when you listen to interviews with many CEOs and people who founded things and invented things or whatever, they talk mainly about their passion. With you, you talk a lot about intelligent strategy.
Ah.
Much more than you talk about passion. Which is interesting and I think is noteworthy.
It's interesting you say that. I mean, at the end of the day, our business is about providing great service. Execution is our real key. You know, we do have a great business plan. And I don't, you know, I was asked at one point the importance of, you know, should entrepreneurs just go and follow their dream? And I do think it's important, but to be successful, you need a plan. You need to understand your competition. You need to reflect on what the reality is when you actually start your business and start to evolve your company and innovate. And so, I think we're very passionate at what we do, but we need to be intelligent about how we do it so that we offer the experience and the services that our customers need. We need to reflect not only on how we see life, but really trying to, look at from the customer's perspective, what is so important to them and garner a business and services that relate to that. And so I think planning and process is very essential in order that you can then develop the passion and the culture to deliver. They say brand, they often equate branding with advertising. I equate branding with execution. It's delivering on the promises that we talk about. It is making sure that our team at every level, in-store, home delivery, and aftercare, really understand how they can affect the customer and what we have to do to make an exceptional experience. And so empowering that process is so critical, and creating a structure that does that and creating your team and involving them and recognizing them, rewarding them and training them, that is so critical to us.
Is that the advice you give young entrepreneurs?
I do. The one of the things that I would say too is, because you've heard my focus, is that we really do distill our business to three things: top of mind, in-store, and home delivery. And it is what we focus on for the last 20 years. And so I think sometimes individuals in companies, or if you're a person who has a dream, distilling that into the key successes that truly will make it successful and not being too distracted by a whole host of other things that can come in is very, very critical. You know, every decision we make is about how will it improve the customer's experience, or how does it make us more efficient.
Okay, when we come back from the other side of the break, we here at What She Said are very big on corporate social responsibility, CSR, and your philanthropic efforts are amazing. So we want to talk a little bit about that and why it's important to you and Sleep Country Canada.
You're watching What She Said on YouTube.
One of the things that has always struck me, and every time my children grew out of a coat, we dropped it off at a Sleep Country store during the campaign. But your corporate social responsibility, I was looking through the list. I mean, you're involved in a lot of things, from Movember to give a kid a coat to... Why is that so important to you?
I think, Kate, it is important. I think from the very beginning as we started the company, I think there is an onus on business to be creative and finding ways to be a part of the community. I think our experience has been from the very beginning, it certainly came out of a byproduct initially of, as we delivered a new bed to a customer's home, there was an opportunity for us to provide a service, right, as it relates to taking away their old mattress if they didn't need it. But then what do we do with that? And we could add it to the landfill, which was would have been a problem. But there was an opportunity to offer it, because many beds, based on just people's experience or new technology, they change their beds more often. Mm-hmm. They're still in very good shape. And we know that there is a number of individuals in our community that can't afford a bed or find themselves in circumstances where they're fleeing. So they need, shelter, and they need assistance in setting up that. And so from the very beginning, we thought there's an opportunity for us to be a part of that, to give back to the community. What I found so so amazing is that it becomes a juggernaut, right? So at the end of the day, we have this our gently used bed program where mm-hmm. we offer to take away your old mattress. It either goes to a landfill. I mean, it either goes now, we recycle it 100%, or we can donate it to someone who needs it. And last year alone, almost 50,000 beds were donated to someone who needed it. Over 60,000 were recycled. Because not everyone needs to they use their bed for whatever reason, in another room or whatever. Then we found that we were being approached on a number of different agencies as well, where we could also add value, either by volunteer or advocacy. It's even just creating the awareness around mm-hmm. an organization in our community that needs support. In our case, it could be bedding. But they could also, we could help make an appeal with them to the community to say that, you know, there's this agency here that needs some help. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's interesting when a byproduct of companies, or when you look in your cupboard, for example, for our Give a Kid a Coat program, which we were just running and just collecting at our stores and tallying up how many. But I had children, mine are 14 and 17, but when they were younger too, they grow into their new coat and out of their new coat by the end of the season, and it looked absolutely brand new. And so there's an opportunity for us to be creative. And what I find interesting is our team love the aspect that we are involved in the community, and it helps. It's one of those things culturally that develop within our organization that we care. And then there, I think customers also certainly acknowledge that, and they might make a choice to come visit Sleep Country because we're involved. And so I think in business, as in the community work, there's a real opportunity for win-win. And it makes us feel good. I think we do some great things in the community, but we're also really passionate and increasingly figuring out ways for us to be, you know, grassroots and local in the areas in which we operate.
Well, that's Sleep Country, but Christine Magee, who is not the CEO of Sleep Country, also does a huge amount of philanthropic work. You have shelves filled with awards for all the things you do and all the ways you give back. So it's obviously a personal priority.
Oh, I'm lucky. I live in Canada, and I'm privileged to have grown up in a family where my parents, the most important thing in their lives was their kids. And not everyone has that, mm-hmm. right? And then I middle-class kid, went off to university, done all right in life, you know, have a great husband. You know, there are aspects that I have to be grateful of. And the fact that I can do something, I can be involved, I can lend my name, I can sleep out for Covenant House. You know, a few years ago, when my daughter was 13, we went with Sleeping Children to India in order to do bed kit distributions, because I wanted her and I to understand how lucky we are to live here in this country. And so those are life-altering moments when you get a chance. And so the fact that I can give back, I hope to, and I think that's a privilege that I have.
All right, we've talked a lot about the company, we've talked a lot about your philanthropic events, but let's talk about some of your personal things. You've just said that you're privileged, you're lucky to live in Canada. What's the top thing on your bucket list, something you've always wanted to do or place you've always wanted to go?
Wow, you didn't tell me you were going to ask me that. going to ask me anything.
That's true.
I think it's an interesting thing. I have traveled a little bit. One of the things that I am now putting, and I love this idea of a bucket list, by the way. I like the idea of planning to drink, because I never used to. I never wrote down actually what I really still want to accomplish in my life. I've done strategic plans, you know, to-do mm-hmm. lists, business plans, all of that. But, you know, reflecting, self-reflecting on what is the thing now, the next 50 years of my life, what do I want to do? And I certainly, you know, do want to spend more time making sure that I can be at home a little bit more for my daughters. But, you know, that may not happen just because of how busy life can be. I do want to take the time, by the way, and explore more of Canada. I know that sounds funny, but I've traveled a little bit, but I'd like to go to Newfoundland and spend more time.
I'm in. Yeah. I'm in. Right? That's on my list.
You
top
know,
of my list.
Because, you know, I love to travel, and there's so many yep. things around the world, but there's a lot within this country, and to mm-hmm. start to celebrate the Canadian culture.
Well, Seamus O'Regan has said that he will set us up with Newfoundland and Labrador. He's down there. there now. He knows everything, every place to go. So
yeah, and all the Marys.
We'll connect you.
Well, that would be terrific.
And he knows all the Marys.
All of them.
All the, you know, the new feet Marys, and they've said, you know, we'll plan it. We'll tell you.
Well, and it's not even, like, it's not even traveling outside of, you know, Ontario. There's so many things within the Ontario, you know, the country, that there are different places and vineyards, and, you know, I mean, there's opportunity for us to celebrate more what we do right here in this country.
Absolutely.
Now, something we don't know is, we want to know what your guilty pleasure is. Now, there are people who would put their hand up for wine and chocolate in this room.
Two hands up.
I've raised my hand as well.
pedicure, I mean, whatever. Something that just is your
orange
guilty
is the new
pleasure.
Black.
Whatever it is.
Guilty. You know what's funny? I do like occasionally to have a glass of wine. You know what I love to do?
I like to have it more than occasionally.
I know, I'm just being appropriate.
Yeah. Okay.
But, you know, honestly, that opportunity where you sit in your living room, put on a fire, and open a book and not do anything. Mm-hmm. Like, even though there are a ton of things on your to-do list, or you're supposed to go and get this done, that it's not that guilty pleasure just to spend time and do nothing, to relax and for a moment live in the moment. I, honestly, that is pleasurable.
Well, Kate talks about going off the grid.
Yeah.
All the machines go off, the cell phone, the smartphone. She doesn't answer the phone. She doesn't
go
on the computer.
Go up to Glen Burnie Lodge, lodge.
She just goes off the grid. And whether it's reading a book, going for a walk, just... I don't exist for the next.
And those guilty pleasures of that Zen moment, for me, it would be on my deck at the cottage, looking at the bay and the water, and for a moment just saying, wow, thanks. You know, it's a lovely thing.
Okay, so this leads into, you know, the question that all successful women are asked. We kind of apologize in advance, but you do have the family, you've got a great marriage, the big job. How do you juggle it all and keep that Zen feeling going?
Well, you know what? I get asked this all the time, and I talk about the issue because I get asked about balance, you know, and is it possible for you to have it all? And I say, it's impossible to be balanced all the time. And I think it is forever elusive. I think there are days where I feel like I'm not getting anything done well, and I'm not spending enough time at home, enough time in the office. You know, it's just, you feel guilty about lack of time. And I think that is pervasive. It always happens. And then there are days where you start to realize that, you know, at the end of the day, am I willing to give up any of those things that I'm doing? And if I'm not willing to give up any of those, then I have to live with that feeling of being, you know, uncomfortable. And I, you know, I kind of say that I think balance is getting comfortable with the feeling that I'm always going to feel a little bit uncomfortable. And then I've got to take responsibility for all the decisions I make. And then I have to find those moments where I can live with perspective in life. And my kids give me great perspective in life, and so does my husband and my friends. And then I just have to say, you know what, suck it up and live and enjoy it. And that's just reality.
Well, happy anniversary coming up.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Christine McGee, thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your story, your insights with our listeners across the country. There is no doubt you are simply the best.
Oh, thank you very much. It's been my pleasure to be with you this morning.
Click the channel subscribe button for full-length interviews and more from What She Said here on YouTube.